Greetings everyone and welcome to today's webinar, Best Practices of Auditors. Great to have you all here with us. I am Arta Lamani, the Account Manager of Quality Management Systems here at PECB and the organizer of this webinar. This webinar will be presented by Kefah El-Ghobbas, PECB Certified Trainer and Organizational Development Expert and Operations Manager at TURBO CARBO. Please feel free to write your questions and comments in the question box in the right-hand control panel, or you can use the raise hand function. We will unmute you, and you will have a chance to ask the question directly. Kefah will answer to all questions accordingly at the end of the presentation. Please, Kefah, you may continue with the presentation. Kefah, yes. you can continue with the presentation.
Yes, thank you very much. I would like to welcome everybody in our session for 30 minutes. It's regarding for the best practices in auditing. My name is Kefah El-Ghobbas. I am actually holding a BS Mechanical Engineering in Road Vehicles. I'm working more than 17 years in organization development, excellence programs, quality, health and safety, and environment. In my career, actually, I have learned a lot of from the, I would say, the mistakes which during the implementation of a quality management system or HSE system. And these practices and this is gained experience, I would like to share it with the most of the common people who's coming, and I would like actually to invite you for any questions you would like to ask it, and I can answer it after the end of this session. First of all, we would like to talk about the first of all main mistakes actually we have it from the auditors, that is the misunderstanding of some fundamentals of the audit or concepts and principles they would like to implement it during all the auditing and planning of the program of the audit. One of the major things we have to understand what is the auditing in the main of not just only quality management system, also with the QHSE systems. So simple as we have it as a definition, is a systematic, independent, and documented procedure or process for obtaining audit evidences and evaluating its objectively to determine the extent to which the audit criteria are fulfilled. Here is if we are looking for this kind of information, it's coming from the standard. Systematic, it's mean that every time we are planning and we need to implement it, so we have to make that continual improvement. This is one of the major thing, and the auditing, if we would like to make it more continual improvement, it has to be systematic. The second pillar it's of the auditing is has to be independent. So you could not actually audit the area where you are supervising, and it depends on the type of the audit, so it takes that the type and degree of the independency. Documented the procedure, so it's very important that to have everything, it has to be documented, it could be referred to it. Now if we look at these black points, or I would say highlighted black words, this is the main criteria which is make the audit is valid, and it could be failed the audit if it's not these important four pillars is exist into the process of auditing. Now the integrated management system during this audit, or based on this definition, we have to check effectively accordance to the systemic criteria. Now the systemic criteria, that what is the scope, at what extent, and what we need to get as output from the whole design system. What is difference between efficient and effective? Effective, we are talking about the proactive. So we have to look into the system. Once we are looking to auditing, we have to look that this system is a proactive and is a prevent from any bit failures from manufacturing or producing services or a product which is make the clients is dissatisfied. The audit guideline. Now one of the most important, if we are looking at to the audit, there is, it should be any reference where you need to refer it once you need to have a doubt. Now my advice for all the auditors or the people who is always looking after this business, or maybe they are working in this field, is not important that I do have the things in my mind. The first thing is have to have a reference. Now this is standard is very important to you. Once you have a doubt, return back for it. Don't rely on your memory. Always the memory for the people is always sometimes is varied from person to person. So use this reference, and always it has to be in your pocket. Guideline on equality and or environmental management systems auditing. Now here is very important for the auditors and all the experienced auditors we are talking about. Now here is this system, we call it why we have environment and quality management system. Here is this reference is talking for the compound 2 system because they are certified system. Some people they are asking the occupational health and safety. We are talking about the occupational health and safety. It's a guideline. Now a time it's come for to have international standards where for the occupational health and safety, and it will be integrated with other 2 standards. 4 important thing once we are looking for the guidelines, which we need always to have it in our pocket, which I advise very and recommend it strongly that to have it with your pocket, that the principles of auditing, management of audit programs, audit activity, and competency of the quality management systems. What is the principle? One of the major thing is the ethical conduct. Now the auditors, there is very important thing they have to think about it. It's not a revenge, especially on the people who is internal auditors in the companies. Sometimes they found that the auditors are time and the occasion where they can, I would say, attack the people who is actually don't like them. This has to be away from that. And also, if you would like to be ethical from another point of view, you have to agree with the people who is actually as auditees to understand with them that there is non-conformity, you need to make the improve. And this is one of the things is most important. Also in some cases, especially on the people who is working in the third party, that is the blackmail, or maybe we can see the bribe. This is, we have to be away from this. This is one of the major and most important where it's make the auditors, they are respected, and it has their own level and rank of respect for the people who is working in this business. Now here is the role of, it should be trust, integrity, confidentiality, discretion, and the certified auditors are bound by strict codes, which PCP, they have also code of ethics where we need to sign it for the people who will be auditors for certified third party certificates. Fair presentation. Here is very important and very, I would say, crucial in the business, I would say, on the process of the auditing. Audit findings, conclusion, report, truthfully, accurately, completely auditing the activities. Now here is very important when you are presenting the findings. Most important and most problem, think, I would say, in equal. Most important, you have to address the findings in a way that how is the evidence is come to conclusion, how is the non-conformity come to the existence, and here is, it should be also with the evidences. Also we have very important about no opinion, it should be presented while you are presenting these kind of findings. You are just only frank, and also you need to make it a very clear observation away from any conclusion or from any kind of person conclusion or person opinion. We are third party. We have not to tell them our opinion. We have to give them that true and just only true. Due professional care. Here is very important for the people who is working as an auditor. Now it's most important for the people who's working in this that we have to audit the places where they are expert with it. Some certifications body, they are asking for expert people to come and join their auditors in order to see how is the R comply with the practices of such kind of field of the business. We have to rely on the people who are aware about this one. Also, once we are planning the product, the audit, it's very important for us, once we are planted, we have to take the departments or the activities is relation with each other. As example, if we are looking about the sales, if we would like to make auditing for the sales and the store, and we would like to make the production. Now, here is the purchasing, sales, and the product. They are commonly, we have to make them, how is the auditing is come as input and output. Now the planning of it and how it looks like, it's very professionally, it should be presented to the people. Because once we are visiting the clients, or maybe we are visiting another people, especially for the third party auditors, we can see these guys, if they are not presenting the professionalities of them, they can mislead them completely and they will not get the final conclusion about their compliance. This is the most, I would say, from my point of experience, is the most crucial three pillars. It should be the auditors to be very strong. I would say these things, it has, by the experience, it will be built stronger and stronger, not from the first time. In this case, that is the people who is joining the auditing, so they have to go further and further, step by step, and from member to chief, or maybe to go for leading. Independent and evidences. This is too important also, that is the audit, it has to be independent. If we look about the accreditations and we're looking about the activities now, any certificate, if we're looking, that is the certification body is certifying the organization or entity that they are complying the requirement of the management system. Now the accreditation body, they are actually, or certification body, they are national accreditation body, they are referring or accredited them that they are capable to make the certification. In case of we are to see that these bodies which they are working, they are all of them has to be independent. This is it's make the credibilities of the results is come as certificates or reports. Most of the time is we call it independent reports, and this is make them more and more more credible and more trustable. The fifth one, we call it the evidence. There is no audit without evidence. Now the evidence, it has to be verifiable, so we can retain for it, we can verify, and it should be referred back that is being the activity maintained or it has been done accordingly. Types of auditor, I would not say that is not anybody's know about it. The first party audit, we call it that internal party. I would say internal auditing. Second party is that once is we are doing on our vendors. Third party, this is we call it the certification body once it's come and make the certification. Now here is why is very important and we classify these three types of audits. Now the first party audit, you need it and the demands of it that your own system you are make the check on it that is being effectively implemented, not efficient, effective. Second party, this is one way of it's rely on it major of the purchasing department in order to assure that these vendors they are capable to provide acceptable every time acceptable quality of a products. Third party, I would say that is the independent third party where it's a certification body that granting the any entities that they are comply with the quality management system. Here is very important point once we are making the auditing. Now, if we look at this principle, which is started to be, that is, we call it the process-based quality management system. Sometimes the auditors, they found some difficulties in auditing some areas where they don't have any kind of documentation, or maybe they have talented people, and a few amount of documentation is exist or documented. Now, here is very important principle has to appear in the mind of any kind of auditor, that we are using process approach in order to implement the requirements. Here is, if you look at it, first of all, you have to understand what type of product and what is going in. Probably we have automatic systems in all over and everything is monitored. So what we need to make the check out this process is really calibrated, monitored, and maintained. How we can look after this one? So we have a sentence, policies and objectives in all definite meanings, so customer requirements, how it's being reflected. So once you are auditing, you have to look how they are generating a collection of information about the customer requirement. Then how we would like to set this one into the policy and objectives. This is very important from point of auditing. Collecting of information about the customer requirement. Second thing, the policy, so to see the framework of setting the objectives and to look how they are addressing and identifying their objectives and how they are making the programs of them. The next level, that how they are defined the process and how they assign responsibility of it. This way, if you are making this kind of audit or the way of sequence of how making this audit, it will give you more effectively to reach for the where is the non-compliancy, because this will be more tangible for the results than to go for the documentation wise. Make the measurement tools and for the effectiveness. Here is, you can see what is the KPIs we are use them and how we are measure it. Very important, and always I'm laughing on the people once I'm coming to audit them. I ask them about their business process. When they are providing business process, I tell them, what is the KPI? Now they are asked, there's no KPI for it. Now there's, if I don't have any KPI, how I can capable to manage this kind of a process? Second important thing you need actually to look at it, two KPI as minimum for any process. One is about the productivity, second one about the effectiveness. And this is, it has to show you how is the process is working well. This is the way how you have to follow the sequence of the audit. Here is, you have to look after the means for preventive and preventive non-conformity. Now, as we say, that is the system, the main objectives of the system once we would like to implement it, this is to have our proactive systems. You have to look after that, what is kind of methodologies they are implementing, what type of techniques they are following in order to prevent it from non-conformity. Then, how they are making the review of the system and how is they are using the continual improvement tools. At this stage in continual improvement tools, there are plenty of things they are using. One of the major things which I have met in my life while I was in the working in the automotive industry, we call it the 8D. 8D, or I would say 8 disciplines, or sometimes they call it TOPS, it's team-oriented problem solving. This is one of the magnificent way of problem solving and continual improvement, where it's make the cross-functional team is sit on one table and prioritize their ideas about the root causes, how to contaminate these problems, and also how to verify the root causes. This one is one of the most effective ways which I have met all over my life, and I like always, all the time, to explain it and to talk once the people implementing or qualifying them for any kind of quality management system or other systems where it could be certified. I always advise them with this one, and once I explain it, they like it very much because it's more tangible to describe the problem and how to prevent from occurring the problem. Auditing for continual improvements. Now, if we have seen at the previous slides how is the sequence, if you are any auditor, you have to follow this trail in order to help you to understand more effectively whatever it is the business scope you are make the auditing of it. It is very important for us in how to evaluate, monitoring, and management, the measurement of a product. That organization has to look how is the contribute for continual improvements. Here is the tool, and monitoring is one of major thing how they are doing the action before it's having the pitfalls. So this is one of the major main of the pro activities. If we look at the 8.5.1, one of the clauses we have it, here is very important for us. The continual improvement to effectiveness of the quality management system. Now, if we would like to make any auditing on the continual improvement, so we have to look, if we have seen that previous slides, we have to look about the quality policy, quality objectives. We have to look about the analysis of the data, and we have the audit results, corrective and preventive actions, and management review. All of these, if we have to see it, all of them, they give you how the quality management system is effective. These things, if you look at it, so you can decide on the continual improvement principle is in a place or not. And this is always the big obstacle in front of the auditors that to prove any entities under the auditing that they are implementing the continual improvements. And once you would like to make this kind of the auditing, you have to look after these three points. This is the first one of the major fundamentals and principles we have to put it in our mind once we are going for the auditing. One of the major thing I would always recommending that always to have it with your hand, the guidelines of the audit. And besides of that, you need to have the standards of it. Don't try that you actually have these two between your hand. Sometimes people, they don't like to have it, but you have to refer back probably while you are convincing your auditees about that is your findings, you have to prove to them by evidence of the standard. The second domain of our presentation of today is how to manage any kind of ISO 9000 auditing as a program. Here is what is the pillars of the audit program. Any lead auditor who is actually expert in this one, he has to maintain, in this case, to see what objective of my audit program. In this case, we are talking about how is the quality management system, probably occupational health safety, or maybe we call about quality management system, environment, health and safety. Extent of audit program, to which area you would like to cover, which department, so the, I would say, the boundary of the system where you would like to look for, and how they will be interact between each other. Responsibility and resources required for setting any kind of audit program. Now here is the procedure or the manual where they are implemented, and the most important, you have it that you need to make auditing against the most updated procedures. Records, it's very important that you have records as evidences for implementation of the system. Here is we have to see how is the monitoring and reviewing the planning, the implementation, and how to make the conclusion for the whole program implementation. Now here is, if we are looking for each point of it, now we see auditing program objectives. Here is, one of the most important of it, we have to meet the requirements of the certification or any other standards. This is the objective. Or we are going for which standard, and based on that we will understand what requirement we need to comply with. Now here is very important to see how we to verify the conformance with the contract requirements. Obtain and maintain confidence capacity of the suppliers and to contribute to improvements of the quality management system. This is the objectives of it. Now, factors influence the audit scope. So, an objective and a duration of each audit. Now, what is the difference between the scope and objective? It's very important for the auditors or lead auditors. Scope, it means that the area and what is the geographical and the activity you need to make the audit against. The objective, it's very important that is what you would like to make the verification against what. So this is the objective that you would like to make advocant, or you would like to have a compliance advocant. You are making audit against for the plan, or they are complying with all requirement of the standard by the design of the system. Second point, that you would like to see what is has been designed and approved and covered all the requirements of the standard, they are implemented of the compliance. This is the objective of it. It's very important to be clear in mind. And based on how is the duration is very important to understand where is the location, the distance it travels, the people is coming, and how is big, and the people you need to audit, there are constraints on how is the duration of the audit. Frequency of audits to be conducted. Here is now, it depends on type of the business where we need it. Now, if in case of internal auditing, we are looking after that people auditing places where they are aware about that. Probably the frequent of the auditing doesn't need, I would say, so frequent. But in some cases of the critical processes where it's impact completely on the quality, maybe the higher frequency. That just depends on the type of the business and the product and the process itself. Number, status, importance, complexity, similarities, locations of the activities, all of them, they are constraints and factors, they are implement, they are constraints and influence on the audit program. The standards and statutory, regulatory, contracts, requirements, policies, procedures. It is very important, I would like to bring any attention for any auditors who is working in this field. The statutory and regulatory. It's very important that to take in our mind the implementation, what type of legislation they are implementing. Now, some auditors, why I have to look after that, why I have to see the what type of legislation. I have to look after the legislations. Why? Because one of the major important about the quality of the product, that it has to be legally comply. Now, if it's not comply with the legal, so it's impossible to get the certificate in some circumstances. Needs for accreditation and certification. The difference between of them is very important and how is crucial of it. Now, the accreditation and the certificate. Certification, we call it that is they are comply with it. Accreditation about the third party. Results of our previous audits or previous audit progress reviews, all of these things is constraints on that. Language, culture, and social issues. Now, it's very important at this point, this is also an influence on the audit. Some people, they cross in their mind, maybe some people in Europe or I would say in other countries, they're coming for auditing for some countries, they are not aware about their culture. It could be a constraint, I would say, a barrier of understanding how they are working on it. I do remember this one exactly for one incident. It's happened once is the lead auditor went to make auditing for snacks factory. And the tensions of the store manager makes him that to stop talking. And at this time, if it would not be the lead auditor is be so smart in how to manage the situation, the audit it could not be happen. And this is just to remember that that situation. Significant changes to any functional areas. You have to be aware about that is what is the critical and significant areas where is any kind of changes, and if there is any changes since they have applied and till the time of auditing, you have to be aware about that. These points, which is very important, I would say from the point of results of a previous audit, so the points 7 and 8 in major of the things which is come for very important requirement is to have any audit lead, so who is actually lead you to go over these kind of barriers. Responsibility of managing the programs is especially for the lead auditors. Now here is the responsibilities, the persons and understanding of the audit principles. This is depends on the audit auditors who is going for making the audits. So you have to make how is the group and how they are understanding the principles of auditing. This is will concentrates on will be one of the constraints, which is maybe to extend the audit or maybe be shorter, or to understand and collecting the evidences. This is one of the major, I would say it's not easy, but it has to be a good understanding for the lead auditor to select his team very accurately. Also, he has to have the auditor that the technical and the business understanding for relevant activities. If he would, I would say from sometimes, if you are going for any kind of business, to make it for the first time for auditing, and in spite of you do have any expert people who is following up with you or making the auditing, it will be required and it will be good if to read about how is the systems, or I would say how is the technology or the type of the business is working. This is will be helpful for the auditor even in his or her performing the worker. Resources required by the program. Now, any kind of a program, if you would like to implement it and plan it, you need resources, financial resources. So probably you need that just to make any refreshments. Maybe you need transportation, fueling, and all these type of activities is which required. You need financial resources, so you have to be prepared for this one. Audit technique. This is the audit technique on how to approach. This is communication skills. It's come by the time and experiencing how to make and contacting the audit. Process to achieve and maintain audit competency and improve audit performance. This is very important for any kind of auditors, how to improve his or her performance in contacting such kind of audit. These are very important how to plan for contacting the audit. Sometimes there are people when they are prepared for this kind of audit, they have required such kind of checklist. My advice for the people who is using checklist, this is not as how is call it to stuck for it every time. Just only is a reminder. It's give you how is your direction, but sometimes you are based on the circumstances where you are best and is which reach you. You have to be a very, I would say, intelligent on how to turn the audits onto the way that to get and to achieve the objective of it. Availability of auditors and technical experts, I said before. This is the auditors on the time of the auditing and the technical experts is to help you that to drive yourself through the technology where you are going to audit. Extent of audit programs if it's required. Traveling time, accommodation, and other auditing. For sure, for the people who is traveling to another country or maybe to another destinations, maybe in one country for the long distance, also you need to provide the accommodations. These resources is very important. It should be considered while you are programming or you are making your program. Audit program procedures. Here is a, you need to develop any kind of implementation. This is based on how and how is the responsibilities of distribution for the program. Now, once you are would like to go with a team, now after the kickoff meeting, it will be some groups is spreading in different areas, and the way of understanding of the system, it's help you to distribute these groups in order that results of the observations for each group, it will be linked to each other. Now the selections of auditors, this is one of the most important to understand that the people who would like to audit, they are to have understand and have the competency to conduct the audit. Methods of reporting and maintaining the records is very important, how's collecting your evidences and how to make it. In some cases now is advisable for the auditors when they are sitting for any kind of audits in any department, you just only advise him that we are have our need to collect some reviews or some comments in order that is not to to be afraid from you, because majority of the people when they see you are taking a note, they thought they are making mistakes. So this is one of major thing they are afraid from the auditors because of it. And advice for the auditor always that to give them that presentation to cool and also to break the ice between you and between the auditees. The records and maintaining the records is very important now. Any programs, we have the results of the audit program and review of it. We have audit plan, we have reports, non-conformity reports, report of the corrective actions for follow-up for the findings. This is the records we can gain it from the programs, and we have to make sure these things should be maintained. And also for the people, I'm advise them that they have sometimes bad handwriting, and sometimes you don't understand it, and actually one of the guys who I suffered from this one, I used fairly sometimes to write it, or maybe I can make simples or something like that. And once I'm writing the report, I have to write it very clearly, so it will be readable and it should be referred back for it, because this is any evidence for anyone who is looking after the audit. Now here is also we need the auditor's personnel records, the area is covered. It's very important now we see the accreditations of the auditors. It's that just make them more credible for them, that to understand the areas who's been qualified for their auditing or maybe for the training. Monitoring and reviewing any kind of auditor programs. Now here is the needs for monitoring periodically that the access of the auditor. Now we have to check out that is the audit objectives is being met or not, or maybe it's we missed it through the audit time. Effectiveness of the audit programs, if we are achieving and we can check out that is the quality management system which we are audited, that is we can see effectively it's working or can be monitored. Any opportunities for improvements. Summaries of any audit program. It has to have audit program. We have objective, extent, procedures, resources, and responsibilities. Here we have implementation of the program, evaluating of auditors, selecting auditors' teams, directing audit activities, and make the recording. Then monitoring and review the audit program's how it's working, and after that we have improvements action. Auditor role and responsibilities. Now team leader responsibilities, and we have team members responsibility. First of all, we will talk about team leaders. We have to make a final decisions for all bases of the audit. Here is very important, and I always advise for the people who is going for the third party auditing. Now sometimes once you are going and there is a conflict started to be between two departments or something like that, and they would like a third party to make a judgment, you are not the judge. So you can record this one, you can see the observation of it, and you have I would say the team leaders, they have not to be an influence on this one, only should be observed for this, and maybe if it's useful for your audit and to give it for the concerns team leaders or team members, so you may take it, but you are not a judge. Prepare audit plan. Brief the teams about their responsibility and their need to be covered. Review the working documents to ensure that they work with the objectives and what is being planned. Report the critical non-conformities to the auditee immediately. So you are making actually with them that there are some non-conformities is being observed. More clarification sometimes is being required to close the chapter about some observation before that rising the final report, because once it's the final report is come, so there is no any changes that happen. Report any major obstacles encountered during the audit. This is I mentioned before in the first point. And presented the audit team at the opening and the closing the meeting. And submit the audit reports. So this will be final after the collecting team members. We have to prepare, so including checklist, necessary carry out task, collecting information about the compliance, and looking about the evidences for the compliance and continual improvement. Review all the relevant information related for the assigned tasks. And then the deficiencies and the findings should be reported to the team leader. Team member responsibility during the audit. Very important, stay with the scope. Don't go away. Once you find observations, you start stuck to the scope. Probably this non-conformities is out of the scope of the audit. Communicate the audit requirements to the audit team. They have to be aware about what is the scope and what the requirement and the objective of this kind of audit in order to be always with you, not to mislead you. Collect objective evidences and to see how is the conformance with the requirements. Document the corrective action request if it's required and report the audit findings to the auditee. Verify corrective actions taken in response to the CARs. So once it's been the corrective actions has been raised, you have to need to follow up that it's been maintained this kind of corrective action and could be effective in order to prevent it from reoccur kind of pitfalls. Good practices at the auditing, which is advice. Now at auditing, the auditor should remain polite, calm, professional at all the times. This is one of the major things. Second thing, they should be introducer for themselves. So once you enter for any place, besides that you are with the, I would say, lead auditor or something similar to that, you need actually to present yourself who you are, why you are coming here, and what you are looking for. Ensure the agenda is known and understood. You have to explain that you are keeping to the agenda. The time, it's like money. Keeping to the time, any kind of obstacles or avoid you for the time, you need to reschedule and it should be reported to the team leader. Arguments, you have to be away from it and listen to others, because in your type, now you have to listen carefully for everything in order to make understand and complete clear picture need to draw about the practices implemented in a place and maintain the appropriate records. This is my advice for the auditors, internal, whatever it is, the audit type you are performing, this is one of the most important things you need to follow. Now here is, we have the domain 3 that we call it the preparations for the audit of ISO 9000s. Now here is, we prepare for on-site audit. This is very important to do to make a disk audit. In this case, is we are prepared for to know that, understand what is the systems they have, the activity and the process. Either to have, you have auditors is enough that to make the auditing on it, or maybe you need the experts. This is the disk studies give you that is the some estimation regarding for the audit program. Now you prepare the checklist on regarding for this and what you should refer to, so the quality manual, quality objectives, policy record forms, all of these things. Process map, interactions of activities, it's help you how it's working the business. Here is we have where no documented procedure on interactions. So there is, you have to look at the process maps. And previous audits or results, this is what you need actually to understand how is the compliance is working over there. Work documents, audit procedure, checklist, that for the auditors, not for the enterprises. Here is you need audit procedure, checklist, and sampling plan. Audit plan, forms for recording information, supporting evidences, records of meetings, and audit findings. In some auditing where we need to make pictures, this is especially in case of the occupational health and safety, the evidences, it could be on the picture-wise, where it helps you to describe the non-conformity. Because the occupational health safety, if you look at it, this is practices, and these practices, it has to have, I would say, more evidences in a picture than the to take a document or record and to make it as evidence. In the checklist, here is the purpose of the checklist, and this is my advice for the, all the people who is working on this. The purpose of the checklist is acting as a guide for the auditors to ensure the objectives and the audit are met. Advantage of it is preparation for such kind of map, how is you would like to target and conduct the auditing, and as well how you would like to perform this kind of audit. The disadvantage of it is sometimes they are used it as a standardized one and may stifle the initiatives. They also maybe prevent the auditors from investigation furtherly when they are observing such kind of problems. Number six, how to conduct the thousands of thousands audit. Contacting the audits, we have collecting and verifying information during the audit and verify how is the consideration of the audit evidences. Now here is the audit evidence, how we can consider this one. It's record, statements of fact, or other information which is relevant the audit criteria verified. So audit evidence should be undefined, documented, and recorded. This is the conditions if we can consider audit as audit evidence. Now the auditor should adopt positive and a professional and constructive approach. So this is one of the major things. It has to be how is presenting yourself into collecting or conducting the audit, because in some cases the people, afraidness of the people, it will make build a barrier between the audit and audit between the auditors and the audites. In this case, maybe it will be not cooperative, the such kind of situation. What shall I do in this case? Meet the area representative first. Always talk to those performing the task. Explain the purposes of the visit. Be calm, polite, and reassuring. So repeat back again what he has said, not because you would like just only to repeat, but to make understand that you have collected all what you want. Never talk down, never act as a supervisor, speak clearly and carefully. Now here we have to use all the sense. So if you have seven sense, six sense, anything that's related is help you to make sure that all the confidence about the conformances has been in a place. Here is we have to examine the objectives. Again, is that what we have? The most advised for the people to understand the process and to collect the information about the practices implemented in a place, that to use open-ended questions. Open-ended questions will be helpful because the people who is working, they always would like to explain what they are doing and how they are doing the things. And this is make them very, I would say, contactive to the auditors. And the auditors, they can select as much as they want from this information. What you don't need to do. Be sidetracked. Be late or mislead. Bogged down. Let at the auditee detect. Dictate places of audit. Now, here is very important and very important for all the auditors. Sometimes the auditees, they would like just only to get away from the audit. They used to put in front of you some transactions or records, whereas they fully of mistakes, just only to report the non-conformity and they're going away. Now, don't let them to do that with you. Or maybe the, I would like to show you some place. No. Just only go as you planned. Don't let them to dictate you where you would like to go. Don't make any pre-assumption or assumptions. Just only evidence and make conclusion based on evidences. What you need to do, be prepared, punctual. Instead on the person questions, answer themselves. As little talking as possible. Listen, more listening. Avoid misunderstanding and keep questions a clear conscience. And be polite and calm. These advices, it's help you actually to develop, you need to develop in this case the listening skills. This is the listening skills it's give you because you are observer. You are not dictator. I would say, dictating the people, or maybe you are not the supervisor. You need to listen to them. Your job purposes is to verify either they are comply or not comply. Closing the audits, if we would like to make the audit review, so the audit review will include the study of notes and all the comparisons of the notes of the team members, so we are collecting everything and how we conclude them together. Review the checklist and all the observations which is included. Findings, and we make collecting all the evidence to make the compile for the whole report and the findings. Decision on non-conformity and observations, and writing and classify the corrective actions when it's required. Non-conformity is defined as non-fulfillment requirements. The requirements is, I would say, maybe you are talking about legislatives, maybe you are talking about standard, maybe you are talking about not implementing and following the procedure. All these are requirements, not just only requirements as by the contract or by the clients. All of these requirements and has to be fulfilled. What is mean non-conformity? Here is very important. Once we have decided between the auditors and the lead auditors, I would say the auditors team, that there is non-conformity. Now, what does mean that? There is a failure in complying with the standards applicable to the organization. So this one we see that is the clauses which is required is not being covered, and in this case it's not adequate. The system, they have it. Failure in implementing the quality policy, the process, this is, we call it compliance. So there is two type of non-conformity. We need to be very careful about this one. Either is not covering the requirement of the standard, or it's not implementing it. This is the two types how we are auditing the things. Now, failure in implementing legislatives or contract requirements, this is the client's requirements. These are the three main areas where we need to concentrate while we are observing the non-conformities. Now, the non-conformities, once we are decide on it, it's very important to decide it's a frequent one, which is fail the system, or it's need for the improvements. Finding the statements. If I would like to make any statements for the finding, here it should contain very important once you are writing over of findings. It means that I went to that department. This department, we have selected samples, the sample of any order, what type of orders, and we found that and that and that. Now, description of deficiency, it's been our finding, it's not comply with this or that. After that, the summary of the requirements, that is non-conformity, and this non-conformity is major or minor. Where shall I write the findings? Especially on the CARB, which is mean corrective action request. This is to inform where the auditor can write the following report non-conformity, show the level of non-conformity, its main or major or improvements notes, record acceptance of audits on non-conformities, record the action level it should be taken. So in some cases, once we are talking about the second level, I would say it's second party audit. Second party audit, you need to recommend the corrective action, and third party, no. It will be left for the auditees. Record the acceptance by auditors. Don't go away from the place where you are auditing unless that being confident they are not complying, and it has to be signed by them. This is, I know, the number four. I would say number five is not the most easiest one. Now, here is the development of the skills of the making the confidence, or to, I would say, to make them agree on it. It's not that easy one. So I would like to thank you very much for attending, and if there is any kind of questions, it's mostly welcome.
Thank you, Kefah, for this very informative presentation. We are running short of time. However, I will ask a question that I believe combines most of the attendees' questions regarding ISO 9001:2015 version with auditing strategies. The question is, I'd like you to clarify if the latest updates in the ISO 9001:2015 and 14001:2015 has implied any significant changes in the auditing strategies compared to the strategy in the 2008 and 2004 era.
There is no any definite strategies has been changed on this one. Only that is the requirement on the standards has been changed. Now, always they are using the business process approach. Process approach to management. This is not being changed into through all three standards. So that means that is the changing on the audit methodologies is not, there is no changes on it from the early stage. So if the process approach is in a place, so we have to follow the continual improvement or process approach auditing methodology. That's it.
Thank you again. Because of the time limited, we will have to conclude this presentation. However, if you have any of the questions, you can send your questions through email and we will answer to them individually. I also want to thank all the attendees as well for taking the time out of their busy schedules to join us today. We hope you enjoyed the webinar. To keep up with our webinars, please check PECB's webinar schedule in our website, PECB.com, or our social media network, since next week we are organizing webinars on interesting topics. Thank you again, Kefah, and everyone else. Enjoy the rest of your day.
Thank you. Bye.
Bye.
Bye.